Welcome, I'm Seth Boustead. I am the concert lecturer for the Grant Park Music Festival's 2021 season. The concert that I'm going to talk about now will take place on Wednesday, August 18th, and it contains three pieces that are gems in their own right, though they aren't performed super often. So this is a fantastic chance to check out some new music by composers whose names I'm sure are familiar. It opens up with Felix Mendelssohn's Sinfonia No. 8. This is a piece for string orchestra, so we'll give the winds, brass, and percussion a break and showcase the string players. And then we move to Schubert's Mass in G Major. This will feature some players from the orchestra, bring in an organ, and we'll also showcase the Grant Park Music Festival's chorus under Christopher Bell. And the concert will close out with Benjamin Britten's Rejoice in the Lamb, another piece to feature the chorus. And that's a fantastic work. It really showcases a lot of different aspects of Britten's personality. I'm going to spend most of the lecture talking about the Schubert Mass because it's the largest scale work on the program. And I think that the Mendelssohn really speaks for itself in many respects. Mendelssohn didn't set out to write a giant piece here. He's not making a big statement necessarily with the Sinfonia. He set out to write a fun piece of music, and he did. I will talk a little bit about the Britten as well, but I'm going to spend most of my time talking about the Schubert. Schubert wrote his Mass in G major in the year 1815. Politically, that was an enormous year in Europe. That was the year that Napoleon was defeated at Waterloo. And Napoleon, during his career, completely remade the map of Europe. I mean, he moved people, kings, countries, everything around like chess pieces. And so for him to be taken off the board, so to speak, was huge politically. It was also a huge year, on a much smaller scale perhaps, in the life of the composer Franz Schubert, who was living in Vienna, Austria. In fact, Schubert was a native of Vienna, unlike Mozart and Beethoven, who moved there to seek their fortunes and find their fortunes and do quite well. Schubert was a native of Vienna, and he was an incredibly prolific composer. That's something you have to know about Schubert. He is a guy that wrote hundreds and hundreds of songs, I think more than 800 total. He wrote symphonies, chamber music, operas, six masses, I mean, just an enormous amount of music, which would be impressive for anyone, but he died at the tender age of 28. He was sickly a lot of his life, actually. He was also given, apparently, to partying, to staying out pretty late, which probably didn't help his sickliness and makes it even more incredible that he wrote so much music. If you actually add up the music that he wrote versus the number of days that he spent on this planet, you have to draw the conclusion that he was pretty much writing music all the time. And 1815 was an especially prolific year for this prolific composer. In that year alone, he wrote over 100 songs, and he wrote the Mass in G major in 6 days, which is pretty incredible. The Mass itself has, well, all Masses have 6 movements, and so he must have done a movement a day, and then I guess on the 7th day he rested. You hope that he did. He went to a cafe and had some fun. Let's talk about the Mass. The Catholic Mass has 6 sections, and they are the Kyrie, the Gloria, the Credo, the Sanctus, the Benedictus, and the Agnus Dei. I'm going to play a little bit of each movement. In this Mass, Schubert wrote this for the parish in which he grew up. It was meant to be performed there. I don't believe this piece was actually performed during his lifetime. I don't think it was performed until about 17 years after his death, so he wouldn't have gotten the chance to hear it there, unfortunately. The piece, it does not necessarily have deep religious feeling in it, though. It is instead very typical Schubert music in many respects. In Schubert's lifetime, we're moving away from the classical era. We're moving away from these giant architectonic forms. If you think of Beethoven, these big forms. We're moving towards the Romantic era, where we're thinking about nature, we're thinking about tone poems, telling a story in the music. All of that is present in this Mass in many respects. And remember that Schubert was a great composer of song. Well, we hear that in the Mass. Incredible melodies and very, very lyrical music. I want to play a little bit from the Kyrie now, the opening of the Mass. Typical Kyrie is in 3 sections. Kyrie eleison, which means Lord have mercy. Christe eleison, Christ have mercy. And then back to Kyrie eleison. I'm going to jump up to Christe eleison, and we're going to hear a wonderful soprano solo.
Christ. Grant Park Festival 2021 is giving our Grant Park chorus choristers an unparalleled opportunity to step to the front of the stage. When we started planning this festival many, many months ago, restrictions were in a very, very different place. And who was to know whether we could fly singers across the country, whether we could bring them in even from Canada? And we certainly couldn't even consider trying to get the various different permissions to bring people from the UK. So that's the point at which we turned to the talent that lives within our chorus. Now, I'm thrilled to say that virtually all of the soloists this summer are come from the Grant Park chorus roster. And so it's given me great pleasure to be able to go through the roster and match the solos to the various different voices that I know. I think you're in for an enormous treat.
That's music of Schubert from the Kyrie Eleison. We actually heard the Christe Eleison, the second part of it. And I couldn't help but put in a little tidbit from Grant Park Music Festival chorus director Christopher Bell, because this is an extraordinary opportunity. Normally, for the audience, we get to hear these world-class soloists, but this year, the soloists are coming from the Grant Park chorus, and that's a fantastic opportunity for them. And all season long, they've been great, and I know that they'll be great on this concert as well. So you'll enjoy that soprano solo from one of the chorus members. Let's move on to the Gloria. So this is the second movement of the Mass, and the Gloria is quite simply in the Mass. It is a statement of God's glory. Let's hear what Schubert does with it. I'm going to go all the way to the end and just showcase the sheer power of his choral writing. Schubert is pulling out all the stops here. Well, there is actually an organ in the orchestra, so he's literally pulling out all of the stops here. The third movement of the Mass is the Credo, and this is really the heart of the Mass because this is the statement of faith. I believe. Credo is Latin for belief. I believe in God. I believe that God exists. I believe that Jesus is the Savior. So normally for a composer, this is can be very simple music, very heartfelt music, as you would expect from a statement of faith. In Schubert, though, it's a little more stormy. I'm actually going to showcase two aspects of this. I'm going to start towards the beginning, very tranquil, more what you would think of from a credo, and then I'm going to jump up about a minute and into this incredible stormy section where you think, oh yeah, that's right, we're in the Romantic era now. We're not in the classical, certainly not in the Baroque era. Composers inject their own emotions into even a statement of faith. Thank you. The next movement after the Credo is the Sanctus, and this is a very simple text proclaiming the sanctity of the Lord. I'm going to play the whole thing because it's only about a minute long. Schubert wrote a very, very short movement for the Sanctus. It is a real gem. Let's enjoy the Sanctus movement from the Mass in G major. Benedictus is the next part of the Mass, and it's often attached to the Sanctus. It really is related to the Sanctus. It's very, very similar. I want to jump to a part about a minute in, this incredible duet between the baritone and the soprano. I mean, to me, this is... I would say it's operatic, but not in terms of intensity. You know, they're certainly not trying to stab each other as you would think in an opera. But nonetheless, the give and take, the back and forth between them is marvelous. It is fantastic writing by Schubert. It's hard to believe he wrote this probably in an afternoon. I mean, it's just absolutely gorgeous music that he apparently wrote with ease. Let's enjoy this a little bit from the Benedictus. The Agnus Dei is the last movement of the Mass, and this is the Lamb who takes away the sins. It really represents Jesus Christ and this idea of a Savior who can take away our sin, clearing the way to salvation. Let's hear what Schubert does with it. I'm going to play, go about 3 minutes in, and just take us out to the end of the Mass. This is wonderful music by Franz Schubert. The final work on the program is Rejoice in the Lamb by Benjamin Britten. And this really showcases multiple aspects of Britten's musical personality because he is kind of a complicated composer. On the one hand, he's the composer of the War Requiem, which is almost devastatingly intense in sections. On the other hand, he wrote A Theme and Variations on a Theme by Thomas Tallis in Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra, that is this really fun, outgoing piece of music that really exists only for pleasure, for joy. And then he's the composer of Peter Grimes, especially the 4C interludes, in which he displays this incredible sense of nuance and color. So he's a wonderfully complex composer, and all of that is on display in this piece because they're very short movements. The poetry that inspired this work is by a poet from the 18th century called Christopher Smart, and he spent 7 years in a madhouse. And this is when he wrote these poems. And they alternate mostly between a kind of intense religiosity and a kind of madcap sense of humor in many respects. It opens with a very sincere statement that God is great, God is powerful. And then he starts to talk about his own personal laments. And then it returns to God. So I'm going to play the very opening, again, this very sincere statement of faith and belief in God. And then I'm going to move to one of the, there are three things that he rejoices in, and they are flowers, mice, and cats, interestingly. Of all the wonders, all the things that God created on this earth, Christopher Smart chose to focus on mice, cats, and flowers. So I'm going to play a piece called For the Mouse is a Creature of Great Personal Valor. So we'll hear just a little bit of each, give you a sense of the different aspects of Christopher Smart in his poetry and how Britten channeled his own musical persona to show those off. Benjamin Britten's Rejoice in the Lamb will cap this program. So here we have three composers, Mendelssohn, Schubert, Britten, fairly well-known people, and yet most of us probably have not heard these pieces before. Three gems by these composers. One chance to see them on August 18th. I'm Seth Boustead. Thanks so much for joining me.